Good morning, church. Welcome. We open our service every week with a call to worship. And the Lord who calls us to worship today is the same Jesus who refused temptation to worship the evil one. Rather than accept the glorious kingdoms of this world that he was offered in that moment, he endured the shame of the cross. And today is the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. And Colossians says that now are gathered in him all the treasures of wisdom, knowledge, and glory and power. So would you stand, and with all the saints of ages, let's read this passage from Revelation 5 together. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and glory, and praise. Amen. Let's join together in song. We're gathered in your name, we're calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're seen.
Up the heavens, open up the heavens. We want.
may be seated.
Well, hey, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. We're going to continue with our worship now, this time of our service that we call the Prayers of the People. And in this time of our service, we do a number of things every week. One of those is we hear of what things that God is doing in the midst of our congregation, and also things that God may be encouraging us to participate in as a congregation. And this morning, I'm going to be sharing something about an opportunity that we have as a church in a few weeks, and also pray in a larger sense for this opportunity, which I'm going to share in a moment. But I want to start with this. Earlier this year, in January and February, we went through a sermon series that was looking at the vision that we believe God has for our church. And one of the things that I said during that sermon, what we were talking about, was this. We are asking God, we believe God is leading us to pray through and pursue this, wanting to help spread a movement of gospel renewal throughout Johnson County and into the world. And a phrase that I preached through was this, that God is moving all things in this world from the failure of the garden to the glory of new creation, and that he uses us, his people, to help bring that about. Jesus is making all things new in this world. He's renewing our lives, and he's bringing renewal into this world through his church and through his gospel by the power of his Holy Spirit. Now, that includes one main segment of our society that we see especially all throughout the Old Testament, and that is the poor, the marginalized, the oppressed, the orphan, and the widow. And God's promise from centuries past was that when he brings this renewing power that he will bring into the world, which he's done through Jesus, he's going to change lives. There's a passage in particular in Isaiah that I want to just read to help us hear some of the language that God uses about this. It's maybe familiar to us. This is Isaiah chapter 61. It said this, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, to comfort and mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion and bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair." Now we know the truth of the gospel also is that all of us are poor. We are all in one way or another impoverished and destitute before God, whether that's because of sin, as we'll confess and receive assurance of forgiveness for that this morning. But also we know that poverty, just in material ways, is a real thing in this world. We see it all the time. And God has empowered us as a church to help bring help to those who are poor in the name of Jesus. And one way that we have been given an opportunity to help do that is with an organization called Mission Southside. Earlier this month, Robin Smith shared about an opportunity that her home group, small group, had to go and serve alongside some others at Mission Southside. She was going to help share about this opportunity this morning, and she couldn't make it, so I'm going to do that in her place. But we have an opportunity in a few weeks to go and see more of how God might work through our church in the lives and communities of those who are just needing material help. So what that's going to be is this. On May 13th, our church is being offered a chance to have a bus tour through communities that this organization called Mission Southside helps serve. Mission Southside is an organization that helps come alongside and provide for those who are in need, material need especially, and there's many communities that we have here in Johnson County where people need help. And so our church is going to get a tour of those communities on this bus. So that's May 13th, 6 p.m. to 7:15 p.m., and we have 14 spots. This is just going to be our church alone on the bus that night, and so if you would like to come and see where are areas of need, and where does Mission Southside work, and how can our church come alongside and serve with that organization? This would be an awesome opportunity just to see and have our eyes open to the needs around us and how God might use us more and more to bring his renewing grace to people right next door. So again, May 13th, 6 p.m. to 7:15 p.m., you can register on our website. You can go there. We have room for 14 adults. We're starting this way, maybe one adult per family. You can sign up the rest of either for you as an adult or for some children on a waiting list if you would like to maybe have a chance for them to come too. So go to our website for that. Now, with that said, I want to pray. I want to pray just for our church, for our community, and ask for God's blessing and grace in all the ways that we all need that and our community needs that as well. So let's just pray. Father, we are grateful as we gather this morning, knowing that you have poured your kindness and grace into our lives through your Son, Jesus. That God, when we were far from you, when we were lost, when we were completely empty and destitute, impoverished, you came and you gave us your very life. You gave us everything so that we might live with you now and forevermore. And Lord, we thank you that you have called us to yourself and now have filled us with your power and strength to go and be a blessing. You've blessed us to be a blessing in this world, and we thank you for that. God, we know there are so many needs in this city and in our county, that there are people who are wondering where they're going to have their next meal, where they're going to find the money to pay for their next meal, who are on the street, whose children don't have healthy meals every day, whose the children go to schools where they're lacking in basic materials for just school. Lord, where there's communities where safety is not real, where there's danger every night, there's bad actors at play. So God, we ask that you would bring help to those communities and to those people. We ask that you would provide for those who are in need. God, we ask that you would bring your renewing grace to all these communities in every way that it is needed. God, in this neighborhood here around Meadowbrook, Lord, where we seem to have everything, too much of things almost, God, would you open our eyes to see our lack? Would you open the eyes of this neighborhood to see our need for Jesus, our emptiness before you? God, in the communities where people just need food, would you provide food? Where people are needing safe shelter, would you provide safety? For the orphan and the widow, Lord God, you are their defender, you are their champion. Would you provide help? Would you provide homes? Would you provide safety and security from others and through others? God, help us be a church that follows you as you move toward those in need. And please use us for your glory and kingdom's sake. We love you, God, and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand as we continue worshiping in song? Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Open up my eyes in wonder. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Would you read this prayer of confession out loud with me? I know I didn't bold it in your bulletins, but we're going to read the whole thing out loud together. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The word of the Lord in Colossians chapter 2 says that when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He's taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. King Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Seated.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Fountain City Church. My name is Doug, and glad that you're here. It's fun to see a lot of faces, probably some new faces. I can't see that far back. My eyes are bad. But we're glad that you're here. We at Fountain City, are we over 4 or almost 4 years old? I'm not sure. We're a church plant. We're 4-ish. And we believe that we are a church, that we are a people that God has created to be in relationship with Him. And so we know and we believe that it's through a relationship with Jesus Christ, who died for us and who rose again, that we can have life and forgiveness and eternal life, an abundant life and eternal life. And so we are on this journey of growing to know Him more and more. And so that's why we come together, we worship together, so that we can encourage each other in that. We can spur one another on in that. We can love each other and strengthen one another on our journey. And so that's who we are as Fountain City. And then we believe that as we go from here, we are called to love our neighbors and to make disciples of all generations. So that's who we are. We're glad that you're here. If you're new with us, so a special welcome to you. But we would love to get to know you. We want everyone to feel known here. And there's one kind of an easy way to do that. If you look on the back of your bulletin, there are 2 QR codes. And there's one, if you're new, we would love to just connect with you. You can fill out a short form. And if you'd like to talk to James or me or somebody, Alex on the worship team, we would love to meet with you and just give you more information about Fountain City. The other QR code is, if you have a prayer request, we'd love for you to submit those. We pray every week, every Tuesday morning we pray. And so we pray for the needs of our church. And so please, if there's something pressing, let us know so that we can be praying for that. So that's kind of who we are. I do have a couple of announcements just for events that are coming up. And let me find them here. The first is this. We do believe that we want to be a church that prays. We believe in prayer. We believe that God answers prayers. We believe that God has called us to pray. And so we incorporate that into many things. So this coming Wednesday night, during our, normally when we'd have home groups, we're going to come together here on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock, and we're going to have supper together. We'll probably have pizza or something. But then we're going to have a prayer night. We get to pray together in small groups and pray for the things of the needs of our church. So that's here at Meadowbrook, starting at 6 o'clock. There is a cost for the pizza, and so I think you can register online, and you can pay for it that way so that we have an idea of how many people are coming. So go to our website. And there's an email that's been sent out probably too that has a registration link. So that's the first announcement. The second one is this. This summer, we have an opportunity for our families and children to really grow in Bible study skills. So we're going to be doing a summer Bible study, kind of a survey through the New Testament for age-appropriate study for different ages. And it's something that can be done as a family. We'll do it also kind of through our summer home groups on Wednesday night. We'll be discussing those things. And so it comes with ages 2 to 4 for appropriate ages, 2 to 4, 5 through 7, and then 8 through 12, and then teens and adults as well. And so it's a great opportunity not only for us to grow as a family, as a church, but also for our kids to grow in their knowledge and skill of knowing how to study the Bible. So you can... you can also register online for that. I think are there books to preview over here on the table if you'd like to take a look at what that material will look like. So please do that. And then finally, mark your calendars for Wednesday, May 8th. We're having a kind of a picnic out here in Meadowbrook Park. We're in shelter number one. I'm not sure which one that is. But we're going to be together. We'll eat together. And as my notes say, there's going to be a time of merriment. So, and that is something to look forward to. Merriment. Who wouldn't want to be a part of that? So, mark your calendars for that. So, that's all I have for today, but I do want to read God's Word. We're still in the book of Acts. So, James is going to be preaching from Acts chapter 21, verses 17 through 26. So, in honor of God's Word, would you please stand as I read this passage, and I fetch my glasses to be able to do it. So Luke writes in Acts chapter 21, "When we arrived at Jerusalem, the brothers and sisters received us warmly. The next day, Paul and the rest of us went to see James, and all the elders were present. Paul greeted them and reported in detail what God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. When they heard this, they praised God. Then they said to Paul, 'You see, brother, how many thousands of Jews have believed, and all of them are zealous for the law. They have been informed that you teach all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn away from Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children or live according to our customs. What shall we do? They will certainly hear that you have come, so do what we tell you.' There are four men with us who have made a vow. Take these men, join in their purification rites, and pay their expenses so that they can run, so that they can have their heads shaved. Then everyone will know that there is no truth in these reports about you, but that you yourself are living in obedience to the law. As for the Gentile believers, we have written to them our decision that they should abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, and from the meat of strangled animals, and from sexual immorality. The next day, Paul took the men and purified himself along with them, and then he went to the temple to give notice of the date when the days of purification would end and the offering would be made for each of them." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Want you, oh, before you sit down, go ahead and keep standing up. I'm going to release our little kiddos to their class. So kids, ages 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you have your kids' class. You're going to go out with Miss Anna to that, so you can go to the door and go to your class. We'll see you back in communion. For everybody else, I just want to encourage you to meet someone around you, say hi, greet them, share your name, and tell them how excited you are about the Royals are almost doing well. All right, come on back to your seats if you can. No, you can't. I know you can. Come on back to your seats. Well, it is good to see you all. I'm glad you all could be here this morning. We're going to continue with our time now in looking at God's Word in this passage that Doug just read for us. And we're going to start, I'm going to start by speaking with our kiddos first to help the kids just kind of get an idea of what was going on. And then I'm telling you, kids, today I want you to follow along with me the whole Sunday, this whole sermon, because I think you're going to be able to track with what I'm saying. But something that I thought about as I was getting ready for to this morning was when I was younger, when I was, you know, in elementary school up through middle school, I played a lot of sports. I was on a lot of different teams. And sometimes when you play sports, you can get pretty excited about things. You can get pretty intense about things. And sometimes you can get in close to getting into fights when you play sports. Sometimes it can be with the other team. Sometimes it can be with your own team. Have you guys ever been in a group of people? It doesn't have to be a sport, but have you ever been with like a group of people and some folks in that group started to get mad and intense and there was almost a fight, or they started to bicker and push or something like that? Have you ever been somewhere like that before? I know a few of you have, yeah. We get reports from recess. So it's hard when you're with a group of people and there's like a disagreement or a conflict or like almost a fight, right? What do you do when that happens? This is a rhetorical question this morning. What do you do when that happens? Some of you, probably like a lot of us as adults, you want to like ignore it and withdraw. You're like, I don't like this. I want to get away from this. I just want to go the other direction. Some of you might be like, you know, in the middle of it and fight and angry and kind of you want to push back and you're maybe part of the problem with the fight and you want to keep it going. This morning, we're going to talk about what Jesus wants us to do as his people, as believers and followers in Jesus, when we're in the middle of something like a conflict. What Jesus wants us to do is make peace. Jesus wants us to be peacemakers. That's what we're talking about this morning, that Jesus wants us as his people to be peacemakers. And one of the big reasons why that is I'm going to talk about during the sermon, so you can listen to this and pay attention. It's because, first of all, God has made peace with us. That Jesus came and brought us back to God our Father. When there was conflict between us and him, he has made peace with us. And now he sends us to be people who make peace in the world. So God, big point for you is for all of us, Jesus wants us to be peacemakers. Okay? So that said, let's pray and ask God for his help in this passage, and then we'll keep going. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. God, as we gather here in the name of Jesus, we know and we trust that you are here with us. The Holy Spirit, you are attending to this time, that you are filling us as your people with power to worship and listen and respond in faith and obedience. Lord, we know that you are so awesome and loving and great and worthy of our entire lives. And so, Lord, as we now open your word that we also know is from you and is true, is very God-breathed. Lord, help us to listen and help us to receive what you say. By the power of your Holy Spirit, oh God, would you work in us and by your hand renew our minds and through that transform us that we might be made more and more into the image of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Earlier this year, I told y'all how I've been asking people one question, and I've been doing this for months now, and that question is this. If you could ask Jesus to do one thing in your life, one thing in your family, one thing in our community, what would that be? And as people have responded, there's been one answer that I have received more than any other. I've received it the most. It's kind of a theme that's just risen to the top. And it's basically, I would ask Jesus to get rid of the division, the animosity, the contentiousness that is all around my life. I have a friend who had, at one time in his life, did not speak to his brother, his only sibling, and his brother whom he loved, for over 5 years, at least 5 years. They never spoke because of a silly disagreement that they'd had. In just a few months, we all know what's coming. We're going to have signs all over all the yards, and these signs are going to create a feeling and an environment in our neighborhoods where we're going to start getting the cold shoulder, we're going to start getting the sideways looks, there might be some quarrels, and nobody's looking forward to that. All of us know what it is to desire peace, to ask Jesus to give us peace. And this morning, our passage, as we get into this, is going to affirm this desire for peace, for Jesus to bring peace. It's also going to show us where we can find peace. And challengingly, we're going to be led to see that it might be through us that Jesus makes peace, the peace we desire. So, our passage is in the book of Acts this morning. As a church, we've been going through this study in this book in the New Testament of our Bible, this book of Acts. Just as a reminder, the book of Acts is basically a history of the early church. The story of how the Christian church kind of came into being 2,000 years ago, how Jesus met with his 11 disciples after Jesus rose from the grave 2,000 years ago. He spoke with 11 men and said, God is going to give you amazing power through the Holy Spirit, and he's going to send you. You're going to go all over the world and preach the gospel and plant churches. And the story of Acts is how that happened. And we've seen the church spread from Jerusalem all throughout the Roman Empire, what happened as it did. And in that, we've also seen some of the major leaders in that movement of the gospel. And one of those, of course, is a man named Paul. And we've seen the Apostle Paul. We've been looking at his story as a church for months now. And we're going to continue with him and his life this morning. Remember last week we saw that Paul had decided that God had told him to go to Jerusalem. And so Paul was going from the more western part of the Mediterranean area over to Jerusalem. He was dead set on that, and he went. And this morning we see him arrive in Jerusalem. And as he arrives, he goes and he meets with the church there, the leaders of the church. And in their discussion, the church asks of Paul a kind of request. It's sort of a strange request. We're going to try to uncover and understand what it is. But that request leads us into our first point that I want to talk about this morning. So if you're taking notes, kid, if you're still taking notes with us, write this down. Here's our first point. It's very simple. We all want peace. We all want peace. You know, 20 years ago, 20-ish years ago, maybe a little more than that, when the first Lord of the Rings movie came out, The Fellowship of the Ring, it swept American culture. I mean, some of you aren't old enough to remember that, but most of us are. It just took over. Everybody was seeing it. Everybody was talking about it. And there was one scene in the movie that really, I think, grabbed the imagination of all of us when we saw it, and it was this setting of the Shire. The Shire, this place where the hobbits, the little halflings, the heroes of the story, they lived. In fact, it was filmed in New Zealand. You can still go to New Zealand. They've like set up an amusement park, basically, because people so much want to go and see the Shire. But the Shire in the movie, if you remember, it was just this beautiful, green, lush, healthy, thriving place with wildflowers and big, beautiful trees, and the sun just looked special in the Shire. It was amazing. I think that movie so well captured what Tolkien, the author of the story, meant for the Shire to be. Wanted to convey it as, and the Shire was this place of peace, this place of peace. And of course, there's contrarian people who'd be like, I don't care about that. Most all of us, I think we see a place like that. We see this place of peace, and we go, that's good. I want that. And it's easy to see that's true, because if you think about the opposite, think about this. Nobody wants unpeace, right? Or unpeace, but, you know, conflict, unrest, turmoil. No one wants to live in a country that is at war, that is under siege, that is being invaded, a country that is destabilized, where there's homes being broken, where people are being killed, where there's just constant conflict and instability and unrest. No one wants to live in a country where that's happening, right? We want peace. No one wants to go to a workplace that is constantly in turmoil, where your job is on the line every day, where people are backbiting, where there's arguing, where your boss is awful, where you're always afraid, is this the day I'm going to get fired and your company's not doing well? No one wants to work in a place like that. We want to work in a place of health, of peace, of rightness, of wholeness. No one wants to live in a family where it's just conflict all the time, where there's no stability, there's no order, there's no fun, there's no happiness, but it's just arguing and conflict and bitterness. We don't want that. We want joy. We want strength. We want this word peace means wholeness, rightness, health, rest. That's what we want. This desire for peace is what we see in the middle of this passage this morning. As Paul came and spoke with these religious leaders, and he shares with them, first of all, what God has been doing through his ministry all over the world, and they celebrate and they praise God. After that, they have this request for Paul. And I want to read it again. It comes in this, we'll start the second half of verse 20. They say to Paul this, you see, brother, how many thousands of Jews have believed in Jerusalem, and all of them are zealous for the law. They love the law. We'll talk about this. They've been informed that you teach all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn away from Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children or live according to our customs. What shall we do? They will certainly hear that you have come. So, do what we tell you. Now, what's going on? What's the setting here? What are we talking about? Well, as the leaders say here, thousands of Jewish people who lived in Jerusalem had become Christians. And many of them probably came from a conservative wing of the Jewish people there in Jerusalem who loved the law. And when we read law here, what Luke is talking about on the mouth of these leaders is basically the Old Testament ways that God gave the Israelite people thousands of years before this how to live as God's people. And we can read about that in books of the Old Testament like Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, how God gave the Israelites these books and these ways for them to order their entire society to be God's people. How to set their calendar, how to treat one another, how to order their business, how to take care of their neighborhoods, how to raise their families. All of this was part of the law. Now, of course, in the law also, there were religious elements, how to worship, how to obey God. There were things like that. But the law, in the whole sense, was more like to follow the law is how you actually be Jewish. This is how you live as a Jewish person. I mean, think it built their culture. It gave them a heritage. It gave them a sense of ethnicity. You can't be Jewish, really, without the law that God gave you. I mean, think in America, we have something similar. We have an American culture. It's kind of more difficult to pinpoint these days, but there are parts of us in our nation that make us American, right? You have 4th of July. We love to celebrate the 4th of July and go see fireworks and have a party. We have our whole calendar with holidays outside of 4th of July, like Memorial Day, Labor Day, Thanksgiving. We still sing the national anthem before a sporting event. In some schools, we still say the Pledge of Allegiance and things like that. We have laws that govern our nation that give us a kind of culture, right, that's part of being American. What these Jews in Jerusalem why there's conflict or potential conflict that the elders are talking about is that these Jews who love the law have heard wrongly. They've heard wrongly. They're wrong in what they think is going on. They have heard and they believe that Paul is going around the world telling Jewish people, trash the law. Get rid of the law. It's not good. Stop being, in other words, stop being Jewish. Be un-Jewish now. And so they're having this kind of like crisis of like, how can he say that? The law is good. The ways that God gave us in the Old Testament are good. They came from God. Why would he say abandon those things? Why would he say stop being Jewish? What's his? And so there's a fight brewing. There's a conflict brewing. And so these elders come to Paul, and they have this request for him. They say, Paul, would you please do this thing to show all the Jews here that you aren't, like, trashing the law, but that you actually follow it and that you're still, like, one of us. And so they ask him to go and partake in this purity ritual, this way of cleansing yourself to get ready for worship in the temple after a vow that you've taken that you can read about, I think, in the book of Numbers. And just go and do this and everything will be okay. They're asking Paul to do this thing so that there will be peace in the community, in the church in Jerusalem that we all want. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing. None of these accusations about Paul were true. He wasn't saying what the people in Jerusalem think he's saying. He wasn't telling the Jews around the world to turn away from Moses, to turn away from all the customs, to stop being Jewish. What he was doing was preaching the gospel that forgiveness of sins and life with God comes only through faith in Jesus Christ, irrespective or regardless of your ethnicity and your ways and your customs. But putting faith in Jesus and him alone is how you have your sins forgiven and are made right with God and have life with him, whether you're Jew or Gentile. Being Jewish is not what's important or counts with having life with God and forgiveness of sins. It's putting your faith in Jesus. That's a very big distinction. But that's not what they're hearing. Now, also with this, so not only are these Jewish folks in Jerusalem wrong about Paul, what the elders are asking Paul to do, he does not have to do. There's no reason for him to go do this ritual as a follower of Jesus. He doesn't need to. He's already right with God. He's put his faith in Jesus. This law, there's no binding element on him anymore. He doesn't need to do what they're asking him to do. Their request is being made for the sake of Jewish believers in Jerusalem who are less mature in their faith in Jesus. And so the elders are saying, listen, for them, please just do this. Now, if you're Paul, what do you do? What do you do? Because here's where this hits the road for us. We all want peace. All of us want that. But what do you do when establishing peace asks something of you? What do you do when peace comes at someone else's terms? Right? When you're put in a position that may not be entirely fair, when you're misunderstood, what are you going to do? And so that leads us to the second point that I want us to see this morning. So write this down, kids, if you're following. Second point is this. Disciples of Jesus are called to be peacemakers. Disciples of Jesus are called to be peacemakers. Followers of Jesus, Christians, are called to be peacemakers. So let's look at what Paul did, okay? To see this, let's look at Paul's response. Verse 26. The next day, so Paul's had the conversation with the elders. The next day, Paul took the men and purified himself along with them. Then he went to the temple to give notice of the date when the days of purification would end and the offering would be made for each of them. What did Paul do? He did what they asked him to do. In a way that, if you want to write this down, I'd encourage you to write this if you're taking notes, because this is kind of the key phrase. Paul pursued peace over his personal rights. Paul pursued peace over his personal rights. He put the wholeness, the health, the peace of the church in Jerusalem over himself. That's what he's doing. And let's just acknowledge for a second, that is really hard. That is not easy to do in any culture, in any time in history. That's not easy. But I think particularly in our culture, in our time of history, that's really hard to do. Because what are we taught as from the time we're kids in this society, in this culture? You know, fight for your rights. Travis Kelce's not the first one to make that popular. The Beastie Boys made that popular. You got to fight for your right to party. But that's what we're trained to think, right? Fight for your rights. Stand up for yourself. Don't let people push you around. That's how we are ingrained, or that's what's ingrained in us from the toddler age. A couple years ago, maybe a year ago, I was walking our dog. We have a dog named Junie. We were going through our neighborhood, and we went by a house that was notoriously awkward because there was a woman there who just could do some strange things. And as we walked by the house, I realized, oh, we better go to the other side of the street. So we went to the other side of the street because in the front yard, this woman was looking at the house next to her neighbors and was yelling at the house. And in her yard, she had set up 3 no trespassing signs in a row along the border between her house and their house, and she was doing some very nice gestures to the house next door because they'd gotten into some kind of quarrel. It's much easier to push for your rights than to try to make peace. This is everywhere. It's ingrained in us. Daily, what this might look for us, I mean, think about it, it's like it's holding back the apology. It's holding that grudge that you have. It's refusing the invitation to something where someone's kind of extending the olive branch, that metaphor, that saying. And you say, no way, I'm not doing that, right? It's putting signs up in your yard. Paul is serving as an example for us in this passage. He is. And Paul, in that example, is pursuing making peace over maintaining his personal rights. Now, why is he doing that? There's 2 reasons I want us to think about. First of all, first, because God made peace with us. As I already mentioned with our little ones. This is where Paul starts. Paul is a peacemaker because God made peace with us. What is the opposite of peace? If we're going to talk about what's the opposite of peace, the opposite of peace is turmoil, it's conflict, it's brokenness. And the gospel of Jesus tells us that at one time, every single one of us was in a state of conflict and turmoil and brokenness with God, in our relationship with God. And that brokenness comes from sin. That all of us, every single human being, an image bearer of God, every human being to ever live, has not trusted God and not obeyed God in some form. And that sin is an offense to God. And God in his holiness and his justice cannot tolerate sin. And so our sin forces us away from God. We've offended God through sin. And it's created a kind of enmity, the New Testament teaches us, a hostility between us and God. And there is a wedge there in that relationship. It's broken. There's this hostile element. But God, in his grace, his mercy, his love, he didn't want that. He wanted peace with us, wholeness, rightness, rest in that relationship. And so what did he do? He sent Jesus, his son, as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Jesus took upon himself all of the reason for the separation between us and God, all of what sin is and its judgment and its consequence. Jesus bore that on the cross so that all of the hostility, all of the judgment, all the guilt is removed and we can be brought back to God. The Bible has a term for that. You'll see it sprinkled through the New Testament. It's reconciliation. Jesus has reconciled us to God. He has made peace. We were the offenders. We were the wrong ones. God had done nothing wrong. He was the one that was offended. But God chose to pursue us and make peace with us because he loves us. And he wants us to know him and have life with him. So he's willing to give his own life for us that we might have peace with him. And Paul knew this. He knows that God did not hold a grudge, that God is not bitter towards us, that God did not fight for his rights, but that he laid all of that down. And when you know that, as Paul does, and you receive this grace and it goes from your mind to your heart, it begins to change your life in dramatic ways. To the point where now you do what Paul does, and you will give up your rights for the good of others because God gave up his rights for your good. God made peace with us. So now that changes us. And secondly, Paul is making peace because Jesus calls us to be peacemakers. Kind of implicitly, but also explicitly. In the Sermon on the Mount, I know some of you are going through that study right now. Jesus says, blessed are the peacemakers. That's a way of kind of tacitly telling us, I want you to be a peacemaker, Jesus says. But also, if we follow Jesus' example as his disciples, which discipleship is, follow Jesus, we know that Jesus is the ultimate peacemaker. It's through Jesus and his laying down of his life that we have peace with God. And now he says, go and make peace in this world. I saw a quote this week from a pastor who can sometimes be controversial and sometimes get in hot water, but sometimes he says good things. Rick Warren is the pastor. And I saw a quote from him that I thought was spot on. He says this, peace with people follows peace with God, both in possibility and in necessity. As we receive peace from God, we become people who make peace. He also said this, you are so much like Jesus when you are reconciling people. We're called to be peacemakers as followers of Jesus. We all want peace in your workplace, in your neighborhood, in your family, wherever it might be. In those places, as a follower of Jesus, you are now called to and able to help bring peace there. We all want that. Knowing that and agreeing upon that, that's the easy part. That, yeah, we desire peace. The hard part is actually doing it. Because making peace often is costly. That's going to lead us to our third point. Okay, so the third point is this. We are called to pursue peace even when it's costly. We're called as Jesus' people to pursue peace, make peace, even when it's costly. Not too long, in the last few months, there was a situation in our neighborhood that I was brought into and didn't really want to be brought into it. And I was kind of the focal point of it. And I was put in a situation that I thought was really unfair. And I was very misunderstood. And there was conflict brewing. And if I didn't do something, the conflict might escalate, and it would have been my fault. So I had to be, I was put in a position where it's like, I had to be a peacemaker here. And I'll tell you, I wanted no part of it. It's like, this is not my fault, this is your fault. I'm not doing this, you do that. But it was all on me, and I was like, I want nothing to do with this situation. I do not want to make peace. Peacemaking is not easy. It's really hard. We all want it, but we usually want it at someone else's expense, not at our expense, right? Because often it's costly and it's going to be at our expense. There's three ways I want us to think about that. How is it costly? How is making peace costly? Intuitively, you know these things. But we're going to see these actually in this passage. First of all, we might be humiliated or embarrassed. But you got to step out and do something that might make you look kind of silly. When Paul actually went through with this ritual, you know, he's kind of, he might have looked wimpy, right? He kind of might have looked soft here, like, oh, Paul is just, he's the problem, he's a fool, and now he's doing what he's supposed to because he knows we're kind of the ones who know what's true. And he might feel kind of just like, you know, like embarrassed by that. You might feel that when you're making peace. But here's the truth about this. I do want to counter this with the truth. Peacemaking requires strength. Being the peacemaker is what requires strength, not being the problem maker. It's easy to make problems. It's hard to make peace. Making peace takes strength. There's a counter here in our culture. There's a stream of thought or teaching that you might be hearing on the internet that's like this macho kind of like shove it down people's throat approach to life, and that is so false. That is not strength. That is a false strength. Real strength can make peace. I'll end it with that. Second thing, making peace is costly because, as we just saw with Paul, it can cost our claim on our rights. Sometimes we have to give up what we think we're rightful to have. And it's one thing to read Paul do that. It's a whole other thing for us to do that, right? Who likes to do that? It's hard. Third reason is because peacemaking can go bad. It can go the wrong direction. When you try to make peace, you can be spurned, you can be rejected, you can be turned against, you can be misunderstood and not believed. When Paul did this work, we see him do, he goes to the temple. In the very next verse, when this little ritual is over, Paul is at the temple completing this act of making peace. And people who didn't know him and misunderstood him saw him and jumped all over him and started a riot, we're going to see, and they threw him in prison. He was completely misunderstood, completely unbelieved, treated wrongly, gave up his rights, and his peacemaking effort went bad, and he was spurned and rejected. That will happen sometimes. Even still, as disciples of Jesus, we're called to make peace. So let me ask you all, let's make this real for a second. Is there a situation in your life where God is calling you to pursue peace? Is there something maybe with a coworker or with a family member? Something in your neighborhood? Something with your spouse? Something in our church where you're being called to pursue peace? Now, pursuing peace does not mean, let me say this because this is important, does not mean compromising on what is true. Doesn't mean you do something that you in no way should not do. Right? You disobey God to make peace. You never do that. We don't compromise what God tells us to do. But in a neutral way, in a completely, like Paul did with this ritual, it was fine, it made no difference kind of way, is there an opportunity for you to make peace? Some of you have something in your mind. I'm sure you do, because I have a couple in my mind from my life when it's still this neighborhood thing. And you're going, I don't want to do that. I don't know if I can do that. How can we actually make peace? Like, what is it? How does this work? Because it can feel impossible. I don't have a lot of great help. I have two things. I think they're the two things that were taught in Scripture and over and over. The first, you hear me say this a lot, but the first is prayer. We pray. Because the reality is, you and I do not have the strength. As I said, peacemaking is hard and it takes real strength. You and I don't have it in ourselves to do that. We're going to go the other way. We're going to try to fight for our rights. Something's going to well up within us and go, I don't know, there's no way I'm doing that. We need God's grace and power to be able to be peacemakers. One of my favorite stories, I'll give you the short version, is of a woman named Corrie ten Boom. You've probably heard this. Corrie ten Boom was a woman, a Dutch woman, who in World War II was put in a concentration camp because she was helping Jewish people. And she lived in a concentration camp and witnessed just evil things. Inhuman things done to women in the concentration camp. And she lived and she made it out. And after she was out of the concentration camp, Corrie ten Boom, who's a really strong Christian, she would go around and teach at churches. And one time she gave a talk, and I think she shared the gospel during that talk. And after she was finished, a man approached her, came down the aisle and reached out his hand and said, Fräulein, I enjoyed your talk. And she recognized him immediately as one of the guards from the concentration camp that she was in. And she had seen this man do evil things to women in the camp with her, I believe even maybe to her sister. And he said, I've recently become a Christian, and I just wanted to shake your hand as a brother in the Lord. And she tells the story. She goes, nothing in me wanted to do this. I hated this man. There was nothing, no part of me that would be able to reach out my hand and, in a sense, make peace with this man. And so she tells the story. She said, so she prayed. She said, Jesus, I can't do this. I don't want to do this. I'm not going to do this. I need you to do something in me to be able to handle this. And with that, she reached her hand out and shook the man's hand. And then she tells a story that all of a sudden she felt this kind of tingling sensation go up her arm and into her whole body. And she had this true and sincere, her own thought where she said, I do love this man. In Christ, he's my brother, and I love him. But it's only through the power of Jesus in our lives that we can do that. He is the one who gives us the strength to be peacemakers. And we move into that strength. We kind of access that strength in a way through prayer. So prayer is huge. The second way, and we're going to close with this, we're going to wind down and end here. How do we make peace? How do we be peacemakers? We pray and we remember Jesus. Remember Jesus, the ultimate peacemaker. Philippians is a letter in the New Testament. The second chapter, Paul gives us this kind of hymn about Jesus, this statement that's just probably one of the most beautiful in all the Bible. And in that hymn, he says this, Jesus, I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but he says, Jesus, who was God, who was equal with God, chose not to grasp his rights as God, but emptied himself and became a servant and bore on the cross, in obedience to the Father, our judgment. He was humiliated, he suffered, he was treated unfairly, he was misunderstood, but for our sake, he bore our penalty that we might be restored to God, that we might have life, that we might have peace. For our sake, the punishment of our peace was laid on Jesus. By his stripes, we have been healed. It's remembering that, it's knowing that, it's casting and keeping our eyes on Jesus, that we grow as peacemakers. We pray, we remember, and we take one step at a time. We just reach the hand out and say, I can't do this, Jesus, do it for me. And we make peace. We pursue peace, since through Christ we have peace, and in Christ we're called to make peace. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of life that you've given us through your son Jesus. Lord, when we were far from you, when we were lost, when we were dead in our sins and transgressions, you came for us. You were the Father who welcomes us home. You were the Father who runs to meet us when we come with one step toward you, that you embrace us and you give us a fatherly kiss and you put on us your best robe. Lord, your grace to us is so hard to understand. Help us understand it. And Lord, in this grace and love in which we stand through Jesus, help us to give us power to be your people in our each in our unique places and be peacemakers there. Lord, bring your renewing power to our families, to our communities, to our workplaces. Bring your goodness and your truth and your life more and more into our lives and into places through our lives. God, we love you and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to turn to communion as the kids are coming back from class. And if you would like to turn to page 11 in your worship order, please do. You can follow along there. In your Bible, there's a book called Romans in the New Testament. And Romans is a letter that Paul, the same apostle, wrote to the church that is in Rome, that was in Rome. And he says this: Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with our God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access into this grace in which we now stand. Every week we receive communion as a church. We celebrate the Lord's Supper because on the table here, this bread and this juice, it is pointing all of us back to the reality of how Jesus has saved us, how he has given us peace, that when we were lost and dead in our sins and transgressions, by giving his own body and blood, the bread broken, the juice for us, Jesus saved us through that work on the cross. And the promise of this meal as we receive it week after week is this. This is what Jesus is promising you this morning as you receive in faith. That by trusting him, you are forgiven of all your sin. Every way you've said to God, I want my way. Every way you've said to God, I want my rights, and I am right, and you are not right. Every way you've been bitter or held back an apology or done wrong in your life, this meal points us to the truth that because of your faith in Jesus, what he has done, all of that is washed away. As another part of the scriptures say, you were made whiter than snow. You were cleansed because of what Jesus has done for us. God holds nothing against you in Christ. He has no bitterness towards you, no apathy towards you, no grudge towards you, only love. This is what this meal reminds us of week after week. He is for you. He is near to you. He is guiding you. He has his arms around you as his son or daughter. So as you come forward this morning, what I want to encourage you to do as you receive the bread and dip it in the juice is to declare afresh your need for Jesus. You need him to make peace for you. You need him to his work on the cross to cleanse you of your sin and declare your trust in him, that he's already done that. And then celebrate afresh that you are God's son or daughter in Christ. You are made new. You are his, and he is with you now and forevermore. Celebrate his love and victory for you through his death and resurrection. So that said, why don't we all please stand? Here at Fountain City Church, we welcome anyone who's put their faith in Jesus Christ, who trusts him as your Savior and your Lord, to receive communion together this morning. If you've never done that, if you don't know what you believe about Jesus, you're not sure if you really believe him yet, I'd encourage you not to receive communion, only because Jesus made it clear this is for his people, those who trust him. And if that's you, please don't feel awkward about not receiving. You're welcome to come forward and just kind of keep your hands closed, or you can remain in your chair. Both are fine. And we will also be serving children who have been baptized and put their faith in Christ, and only adults, and then those kids, okay? With that said, let me read to us what Paul wrote to the church in Corinth about this meal. You can follow along in your worship order if you want. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that on the night he was betrayed, Jesus, when he took the bread, he broke it, giving thanks, and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after the supper, saying, 'This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" So as one church, let us declare the mystery of our faith together, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Hallelujah. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. The body and blood of Christ, broken and shed for you, receive in faith.
Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, and faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ
quick reminder, all people in the baptism class, come meet me up front just after the service, and we'll talk about this coming week. With that said, church, as you go this week, may God fill your heart with power to walk in the grace and peace that is ours in Christ, the forgiveness and life and joy that Jesus gives us. And may you, in that grace and peace, walk in Christ-likeness, valuing others above yourselves, pursuing peace even when it's costly. The glory of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Now the darkness fades into new beginnings.